Well, the Holy Spirit says just start talking. I don't have anything to talk about, really. I might as well just begin. Let's just start with this. William Walker Atkinson, born 1862 through 1932. He is famous for writing the seminal Law of Attraction book, along with a massive amount of other books under many, many pseudonyms. Prolific New Thought writer. Now, he just happened to be a student of Emma Curtis Hopkins in Chicago. Chicago was the center of the New Thought movement, really, because of Emma Curtis Hopkins Christian Science Theological Seminary in Chicago and her ability to organize and give classes and teach this. And of course, the World Congress of Religions was in Chicago. Swami Vivekananda was there. And this was the center. Chicago really was the center, spread out all over the United States, all over the world. Now, William Atkinson was this big law of attraction, talking about law of attraction, which is super popular right now. Most notably, Esther and Jerry Hicks and the Abraham Hicks material, which is published by Hay House, which is Louise Hay's publishing house, which is a big New Age, New Thought publishing house, which publishes so many books. So this teaching has been around for quite some time, like about more than 100 years. And it's the opposite of evangelicalism. Evangelicalism is saying we get what we want through the heart, through emotions, through the heart. Metaphysics is the mind, seeing, understanding the mind, mental science. You know, Ernest Holmes, mental science, the science of understanding how the mind works. So let's see if we can pull up some of these people. Let me see if I can find. Here's Ernest Holmes. He was another student of, the last student of Emma Curtis Hopkins. This is Ernest Holmes, who founded Religious Science. Science of Mind magazine started in 1927. My grandmother was a big Science of Mind believer and grew up in L.A. Los Angeles was the hotbed of the New Thought ideology and many different ideologies in the 1920s or so. And it really got cooking when this man, Doug DeVorce, who founded DeVorce Publishing, which is now down in Camarillo, down there, Southern California, he actually published the works. What got him famous is the publishing the works of this gentleman right here. Baird Spaulding, Life and Teaching of the Masters of the Far East. Volumes 1 was extreme big seller. Volume 2, there's eventually like 6 volumes. This really, really galvanized the imagination of the New Age public, the New Thought public, about these, you know, masters and yogis in the Himalayas and living inside mountains and all this stuff. And evidently, it was all made up by Baird Spaulding. It was all made up. He never went to India. He was a great storyteller, you know, a very odd individual. So there was this incredible hotbed in Los Angeles, and it was just fermenting. Both my grandmothers actually lived in that area. And you got what else was there? There was along with Ernest Holmes, There was Divine Science, which was founded by Melinda Kramer, Divine Science, and actually, I think it was Nona Brooks, maybe, Nona Brooks, but there was several, it was about, I think, four or five women that founded Divine Science, Church of Divine Science. Another one was Annie Ricks Militz, who was a big organizer of the New Thought Movement. Another student of Emma Curtis Hopkins, as was Nona Brooks, and the founders of Church of Divine Science. Harriet Emily Caddy wrote a book, Lessons of Truth, in 1896, which is Unity Church's fundamental books. Also a student, Emma Curtis Hopkins, Chicago Theological Seminary. All of this stuff and more was percolating. It came out of Chicago, and it came out to Los Angeles, and spread throughout California, and then through all sorts of places in the world. And now we have it, both DeRoss and Hay House are actually in Southern California, two of the biggest publishers of New Age books. I'm just going through anything else that I can find for you here. Ah, here's a picture of Phineas Quimby, who sort of galvanized Mary Baker Eddy and Christian Science back in the day, 1862. He met Mary Baker Eddy, 1862. It's incredible where we've been with this whole New Thought thing and the Law of Attraction. This Law of Attraction is so huge right now in the world. It's sort of the New Age religion, actually. Came out of New Thought, but it was not, I can't read Emma Curtis Hopkins' teachings and come up with what we have now, Law of Attraction. Not really. I mean, her teachings were very elevated, and there's not a bunch of people in the world, there's only one being, just one being. There's not many beings, there's only one being. There's only one being. Here we are in this bizarre world that just leaves me reeling, actually. And the idea is that we create our own reality with our thinking, with our thoughts, and all this stuff. We attract money, relationships, wealth. All this stuff is based on our thinking, our thoughts, and we can have whatever we want, whatever we desire. And I was thinking, what do I want? I can't really think of anything I want in the of this world. I want a different world. How about that? I want a world. As far as money goes, do I want money? No. I want a world where you don't need any money. So they say, well, you can manifest anything you want. Whatever you desire, you can attract. Well, I desire another world, different world than this one. How about that? They never talk about that, do they? That's only this world. You can get anything you want in this world. What are you talking about? Or in this universe. I want a different universe. I don't want this universe. I don't even want this eye. Can I get a no eye, please? Can I not have an eye? Can I not have this neediness? A need to attract stuff and get stuff? How about not having that? How about that Law of Attraction? I simply cannot imagine what to want. There's nothing to want. What is there to want? Like, I cannot understand it. What is there to want? Impermanence? Death? Form? Superficiality? What is this stuff in the world? It's nothing. What I want is the vision of oneness, for sure. That is an experience, and that just nothing else can even remotely come close to that in experiencing. So we have this amazing situation in the world now, and I'm just pointing all this out so you understand the landscape of the whole situation. It's not a little thing that's taking place. Popular television, movies, they're saturated with this ideology now. It's the New Age ideology. And being so prevalent in Los Angeles and Hollywood, and it permeates the culture there in many different ways. There's so many celebrities and stars and seminars and everything like that going on. And it's truly bewildering, truly bewildering. I people say, well, I'm attracting what I want. Well, what? How do you know what you want? How do you know what you want? And that is the first question. So the first question I'd ask the Holy Spirit, what is it that I'm supposed to want? Do I have some needs or something? What do I want? Everything I've ever wanted is been attracting me into disaster. Ended up having, you know, a negative side to it they didn't see. You think you see the superficial positivity, and then it's a disaster. So there's something screwy about the whole thing, for sure. I've always felt that's fundamentally flawed. The entire ideology is fundamentally flawed. There are no people. We're not even here. There is no here, actually. There is no here. Everything already has everything. Everything already has everything. What we are cannot be described at all, cannot be defined at all. I would say Jesus' teachings are so accurate and totally transcendent teachings. The teachings that just simply forget about the world, forget about this dream. It holds nothing that you want, holds nothing that you want. So, all this idea of like this world has just everything, the universe just has everything we want. All we've got to do is desire it, and it's ours, you know. How about a new universe? How about a different universe? How about no universe? How about a situation we don't have any needs? Don't have any neediness. Reality doesn't have any neediness. There's no such thing as neediness. There's no adjustments that have to be made whatsoever. So this transcendent teaching is getting lost in the shuffle, the New Age shuffle, which is just gaining unbelievable, and I'm sick of it, absolutely sick of it. It's time to transcend it entirely, time to transcend it entirely. You know, it's just, you go into these New Age bookshops, which I've been going to my entire life, okay, grew up on all this. My whole life has just been saturated with all of this. I was just like, what in the world is going on here in the world? It's in my opinion, it is simply magic. Okay, it's returning to the Wiccan magic of manipulating men to get what women want, you know, and coating with a veneer, a New Age veneer of sophisticated talk, like it's spiritual. It's basically how to keep the men working like slaves, to keep producing all this stuff and figuring out how to build factories and distribution and production and prototypes and then capitalize everything and get the raw materials, the chemists, get all this stuff, keep producing stuff, keep producing things. It's really designed for that. See, it's really, in my opinion, the law of attraction is how to attract the right slaves to get you the things that you think are going to make you happy. Almost all the channelers are women, okay? Almost all of these New Age leaders are women, actually. It's unbelievable. You just go and listen, and if you start doing it, it just boggles your mind. Boggles your mind. I mean, are there, you know, it was maybe 99% of the channelers are women. And they're all channeling very similar stuff, and to me it adds up to, it's just a sort of a mental intimidation, a way to intimidate men into thinking that they need to serve women, okay, and serve the needs of women, which is vanity, okay, which is vanity, which is getting the things of this world, trying to be happy in this world, that kind of stuff. And it's, men have been brainwashed into thinking, oh, the woman's in touch with God, within higher entities, telling her exactly, you know, how things are supposed to work. Oh, yes, I found this out. Actually, what women do is you use psychic powers to generate a desire form, which then they direct towards the man. And the man then thinks that it's his own thought and says, hey, I really want to get this woman, you know, a diamond bracelet. I really feel I need to get her this thing. That's what spirit wants me to do. And then they, you know, put it on a credit card or, you know, go into debt, whatever. So I got to get this right now. And then the woman says, wow, it's incredible. I was just thinking that, but the universe just manifested that for me. You know, no, it's on his credit card, in debt. He's in debt because of it. This is what's really going on, in my opinion. It's a very slick form of psychic control, okay? And women have always done this. They've always used their psychic energy, of which they have a lot of psychic energy, because of their role in producing bodies. They tend to have a lot of the psychic energy. And so they say, hey, what can I do with the psychic energy? And they find out that they can control men with it, actually. They really can. And they have been controlling men throughout the ages. And this whole new age, new thought thing is women controlling men, is how I've experienced it. And it's subtle, because the men think that these are their own desires, or this is what they should be doing, is serving women. And whatever you want, you know, I'll get you whatever you want. You know, your happiness is my happiness, you know, soulmates, all this propaganda, new age propaganda. It boils down to that. Because that's not what men really want at all. What everyone really wants is a vision of oneness, actually. All men want that, all women actually want that. But that's not what's happening. This is not directing anyone to the vision of oneness, all this new thought, new age, new stuff. It's not directing us there. One moment. So this is what's really going on. For instance, I was contacted in subtle levels of psychic levels by a woman, a female archetype, and told that she was going to come into the world, was already here in the world, and she wanted me to help her get this great spiritual message out. So I really set up like a publishing house, electronic publishing house, video cassettes, audio cassettes, CDs, DVDs, ebooks, publishing. I mean, there's the whole nine yards, publication. I spent my life and money. I spent so much money on I didn't have, went in extreme debt, all this stuff, because I was kept being psychically contacted and told, this is super important, it's going to help the world greatly. Never showed up. Left me holding all the bills, all the responsibility, all the extreme depression and heartache. Never showed up, never helped, never gave me a penny, and never returned anything on it. And this was a psychic thing of females wanting to be promoted and using men to promote them, okay, make them famous. They want to be celebrities. Look at the celebrity culture. You know, I think women are being raised to be like princesses, celebrities. On whose back? On whose shoulders? On men's backs and shoulders. So men need to say no. Forget it. No diet, no deal, no deal. And turn to the vision of oneness. Turn to the vision of oneness, which means to break the bonds, these psychic bonds that are here in this world, incredibly strong psychic bonds, that women are doing this, you know, this spiritual con job on men, actually, telling them that men's role is to worship women. All right, I didn't include the picture of Marianne, what's her name, Milt Williamson, in her videos and teachings, her essential messages. Men's role, the only way men can be happy and fulfilled is to worship women. Okay, it's very blatant. Okay, she's very blatant and super aggressive and arrogant about it. She says, we've won anyway, so why don't we just come out in the open and say, hey, this is what it is. You know, you're here to worship us and serve us, and our happiness is your happiness. And you know, just complete naked vanity and greed and material lust, and you know, just that's what's happening in the world. And we got to break free of it. We got to break free of it. Mm-hmm. We got to start somewhere. Put on hold for at least 2 years. Put on hold for at least 2 years. And that will help a lot of women in the world too, who feel they don't have any option but to go along with this. Whereas if there's some men who say no, enter and allow their witness to witness the vision of oneness, then other people start saying, hey, I can do that too. I want to do that too. That's what I really want too. All right, and then they'll be able to break free of this credible self-deception that's taking place in the world, the new age self, you know, self-deception, the new age. I can just tell, I just look, I go out in the world and say, how do women, what's their attitude? And they realize men are just accessories. Men are just accessories. They're there to get them whatever they want, take them wherever they want to go, do if they want to go on a trip, oh yeah, arrange the trip and pay for the trip and, you know, do all, and just, they're just these handy accessories that do help aggrandize, you know, the self-aggrandizement of the female principle, the women here. That's not what men want, but they never are asked. Never asked, well, hey, man, what do you really want? The questions never arise, do they? It's funny. No one's ever asked me about my life, what do I want to do? Nothing. It's to just assume, oh, what do you mean? You're here to serve women, of course. There's no, why would we need to ask the question? That's what's fulfilling for you. Why? Because we told you it is. And then they claim that the Holy Spirit is feminine, it's a woman, and then, of course, then it wants you to serve that, blah, 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 blah. Absolute rubbish. Total nonsense. This is all part of this deception of light. Light deceiving light. Pretending to be deceived. It's all part of this nonsense. It's a huge dream of nonsense, actually, of self-deception. A lot of people went out to the East India because they were just sick and tired of this stuff, and they're looking for a culture that wasn't so incredibly materialized and controlled, feminized, materialistic, all this stuff, and you know, looking, you know, can you find any men at all who really know what they really want? And they found out, yeah, you know, that they were looking for something like that. And they found these meditation masters who've gone beyond desire, dropped all desire, who had realized that the witness of all this is the false witness. You know, there's some great teachers there were in India and in Himalayas, some Tibetans, etc. Some not so great too. They're trying to escape this trap of the U.S. and Western mindset. It's just a terrible trap. Now, with maybe Hillary Clinton being elected president, that's just going to be the worst thing ever, actually. 2000 was election, late 2016. It's just going to absolutely put this whole thing over the top. She's very much a radical feminist. Very much feels that, you know, that using men to get what she wants, been doing that her whole life. And this continues pattern in the world. Of men getting used, and of course being told that this is our purpose in life, and nobody thinks a second thought about it, and it's always, oh no, no, the women are getting used. No, it's not. The psychic energy is with women. Women have way more psychic energy, and they're very, very clever and adept at using it, and getting what they think they want, which isn't what they really want at all. And the fact is that this entire play of men and women in the world, etc., is all a play of light, is a false play, and we're just identifying with it. Actually, we're not people, we're not persons. The idea that I'm a person, I need to use the law of attraction to get what I want, is nonsense. I'm not a person. I'm spirit. I'm a breeze. I'm as free as a breeze. I have nothing to do with form or this world or this universe or anything like that. Completely free. I'm not in service to anything. No one is. There's only one universal. There's all is universal being. One identity, universal being. Everything is that right now. All is that right now. There's nothing other than that. All is equal light, etc. again, words only go so far. Words only go so far. And that's a level of psychic energy, of spiritual words that were being manipulated and controlled by this, actually. Very much so. And it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And it's the whore of Babylon that is spoken about in the Bible. It's the whore of Babylon is what's taking place in the world right now. And of course, it's very spiritualized, all this rhetoric by a... And the men that go out and talk, they're just dupes. They're absolute dupes. They're not allowed to say anything unless they are dupes, actually. They don't get famous unless they're dupes, okay? You cannot get up there and speak the truth in this world and be promoted by these book publishing companies and have, you know, go all around the world and be famous and have so many seminars and followers unless you're just an absolute dupe. And you're doing what the psychic energy of the feminism wants you to do, which is to promote the ideology that, you know, the divine feminine is the answer for everybody. Ultimately, that's what they're trying to promote. That this attraction, this law of attraction, is the true law of the universe. But the fact is, it's the feminine that uses attraction to convince the man to get for her what she wants. That's the law of deceit, actually. It's the law of deceit. We should not be practicing these sorts of techniques here. Jesus actually said, it would be far better for you to have no knowledge of how to use the light in this realm. Far better. He says you can use it, but it's way better to have no knowledge of this whatsoever. Forget it. Forget it. That's very great advice. Very great advice. Because this realm is again light, frozen, condensed, contracted to the ultimate extent. It just can't get any more contracted. And who wants to mess around with such nonsense? Escape this dream. Don't try to manipulate the dream. Don't try to be happy in the dream. That's ridiculous. Dream a dream within the dream that frees you from the dream. Vision of oneness. Put your attention on the vision of oneness. Put the attention of the false witness, which is part of this dream, but that we don't want to drop it because we have a continuity attack. If we're very afraid if we do. Put that vision on the vision of oneness. Escape this whole matrix. This whole matrix. Don't try to be happy in the matrix. Okay. I know that all these teachings tell you, oh, you can be so happy in here. Forget it. Don't try to be happy in the matrix. It's not worth it. You're going to get end up getting caught up in so much astral intrigue, and so much stuff is just bizarre. Absolutely bizarre. It's vastly better to experience, abide in the vision of oneness. Let your attention rest there. Forget about anything in this world. It has no importance. And eventually we'll see the complete falsity of all of this, designed to deceive us. Our true functioning cannot be expressed in words or defined in any way. Cannot be defined in any way. So why are we spending all this time trying to pinpoint and focus our mind and use our mind to get specific things? This is not helping us. It's not helping us. Don't seek happiness. The vision of oneness is beyond happiness. It's something that is so wow that everything else in the world, all these desires, are like nothing. Like nothing. But we have a massive economic investment now in all this New Age stuff. And, of course, they don't want their business to dry up. They want to keep you hooked. Hooked, of course. Buy some more tarot cards, right? Buy some more of this stuff, more of this stuff, more of this stuff. Go beyond words, go beyond form. Choose the final illusion. I'm certainly trying to. It's just, there's so much resistance from the world. You know, say, no, don't do that. It's terrible, don't do that. And then try to scare you into not doing it. What the vision of oneness shows is so much reassurance. It's just this vast, total reassurance that you just cannot believe that it was there the whole time. I'm not a needy individual, is what you realize. I don't have any needs. No one has any needs. I mean, just the realization is just so vast, so incredible, so amazing. You don't even want to pay attention to the world. You see these yogis that forget it. They're not interested in the world. Not interested at all. Although you bring some of them over to Los Angeles and they sing a different tune, don't they? They go Hollywood, as you say. I mean, it's easy to be disinterested in the world when you're living in Bombay or Mumbai or whatever, Calcutta, and there's just people dying, just the clamor, and I mean, just, you know, the sickness and the death and the poverty and everything. It's just like, wow, who's interested in that? You know, forget it. But if you go over these glamour capitals of the world, you know, and you start driving these fancy new smart cars and, you know, just the glamour and the glitz and everything, you know, then you think, hey, this is kind of cool. How do I get this? You know, so. But the true realizers are abiding in the vision of oneness. You know, you don't think Ramana Maharshi is going to go Hollywood, do you? No, there's no chance. There's no chance of that. So the ones that are trustworthy are the ones that you can look at and say, are they going to go Hollywood? If all the inducements are there, would they go Hollywood? And if you can say for sure, no way are they going to go Hollywood. You're absolutely certain about Sri Anandamayi, absolutely certain she would not go Hollywood, 100%. Ramana Maharshi, same thing, 100% for sure they're not going to. Saradhara Maharaj, 100% he wouldn't do it, 100% for sure. He just spit on it laughing, just zero interest. He said, what are you talking about? I'm already dead. Why are you talking to a dead man? Why do you want a dead man to go Hollywood? What are you talking about? It's nonsense. I already have everything. I already have everything. What do you mean desire? I got to track what I already have everything. What are you talking about? That's what these teachers say. What are you talking about? I need to attract something. Who is this I that needs to attract something? He says, I am everything. I am everything. I already have everything. I am everything. Everything is everything. There's only universal being. What are you talking about? I don't need to attract anything. They ask Maharaj, well, how do you get stuff? He says, look, it just shows up. If it's needed, it's needed. If it's not needed, it doesn't show up. He says, I pay absolutely no attention to it. None. It's like growing fingernails or growing hair, digestion or something of the body. I don't pay any attention to my hair growing. It just grows, just there, it's just part of the, if something is needed, he says it just, it's there. If it's not needed, it's not there. He says that's just how it happens when you're awake like that. Same with Anandamayi, she didn't have any possessions at all. She just traveled all over, and wherever she went, just whatever she needed just showed up somehow. People give her stuff, she says, give it away, give it away, give it away, give it away, give it away. She says, I am everything. Everything is me, I am everything, everything is me. So all is universal being. There's no lack anywhere of anything. How could anyone be such a thing as lack? That's crazy. Remember, the actors in this play are not us. They're symbols that light is using to convince us that light has changed, that there's more and less, there's need, that there's need. So we can play, we can think we're prime creator. The spirit can believe that it's greater than God. That's the whole purpose of all of this stuff. These people are desiring stuff to be happy in this dream. Those are just symbols. Those are not us. Those are symbols of this play of light. These personalities, bodies are just symbols of the play of light. They are not us at all. We are not that. We are eternal, formless, need-free, adjustment-free spirit. This is all just a puppet show. Now, when I've tried to drop this, what happens is a feminine voice says, no, don't do that. It's always a feminine voice, whoa, don't do that. Because it's trying to break the psychic, you know, attention. It's trying to turn the attention away from the psychic control of, hey, you've got to have your attention on the world. You've got to desire something in the world so you can be manipulated. But when you turn your attention off of that, you're not interested in the world anymore. You're not interested in getting anything for anybody. You're only interested in truth, spreading truth, emanating the presence of truth, the presence of the fact that you can turn your attention to the vision of oneness. That's all that's important. But there's this principle in this dream of shouting and yelling at you, don't dare, you can't do that, you got to keep working for me, the whore of Babylon. We're working for the whore of Babylon here, getting her all the things that she wants so she can be claimed she's happy and spiritual. And hey, look at these laws, they're working for me. Look what showed up my driveway, a brand new car. Now, I wasn't the man who worked, you know, 80-hour weeks. It's the law of attraction that did it. Law of attraction, how about that? And again, all of this is to play a light. It's not us. It's not us, folks. None of this is us. That's the good news, isn't it? That's great news. I mean, imagine if you could realize that none of this is us that's happened has nothing to do with us. That would be great news, wouldn't it? It's like, wow. All this madness had nothing to do with us. It's not us at all. It's a movie that light has been producing, manufacturing its own actors and actresses, and producing it and giving them all the roles to play. That's all it's been. It has nothing to do with us. It's just a way to try and keep our attention so we can believe that we change reality. We were able to change reality. Therefore, if we change reality, we must be God, right? If reality bends to what we want it to bend to, that means we must be God. But what we're really seeing is not reality, but a play of light pretending to be different than reality, functioning different than reality, to convince us that we changed it. And of course, light has these feelings that I need to do something, I need to make the world better, I need to change it, I need to work, I need to contribute something, I need to be happy here, blah, blah. Those are all fake emotions, fake thoughts. Those are, light is generating all that to make us feel like it's real, believe it's real. We think, oh, these are real thoughts, real emotions, real feelings, this is what we want this. No, it's not. It's pretense, all of it. Do we really want to go somewhere in the world of the light? They'll say, oh yeah, I really want to go on this vacation, go to this kind of land, go to the sea, this place. And for me, I say, no, I don't. Why do I want to go anywhere? It's ridiculous. See what? See what? Same old nonsense. Exactly the same anywhere. Everywhere is exactly the same, actually. It's all a dream. Who wants to go anywhere? But light, it keeps, you know, having these bodies move around and do things. Now, the body that light is using to deceive can be used to actually undeceive. like a nod to my mom's head. They said, where are you going to go? She says, what are you talking about? There's nowhere I can go. What are you talking about? I don't go anywhere. I say, well, what do you mean? You just move from here? They says, no, I'm everywhere. I can't go anywhere. I can't even turn around. I'm everywhere. I don't go anywhere. I don't do anything. I don't go anywhere. I don't do anything. And they said, what do you think about this world? It's really old. Everything seen here looks really old. Was not impressed by it. She said, the entire universe is just one big park. The entire universe is just one big park. There's no separation, no boundaries. Didn't think in terms of a world, this or the world, that. So we're way off here, in the thinking of the world is way, 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 way off. It is a scam that we ask light to perpetrate upon us. The way out of that scam is to turn attention to the vision of oneness, the witness, the false witness to the attend to the vision of oneness. Turn it there. Now, you may have to do that and think there's not a single soul in the world. There isn't anyone else in the world who's going to do that. It's very likely maybe there isn't anyone else that will do it. Certainly doesn't look that way. So you really have to do it, even though you think there is no one else doing it. No one believes it. Do it anyway. Do it anyway. That's what I'm trying to do. Do it anyway. I can't come across anybody that's done it really. In these times right now. There might be a few, but it's so much lost in the clamor of the world right now. So you really have to do it anyway. That's what I'm trying to do. Just do it anyway. Don't care. You may be just the absolute lone wolf maverick. Nobody else is going to do it. That's okay. The light is not going to reject you because of that. There's not going to be anything less because of that. Facts, truth is not built on quantity. Truth is not keeping track of quantity or anything like that. So somehow we have to get ourselves willing to get our attention, accept the attentional shift. There's a shift of attention that takes place. And again, it's happened twice for me recently. So I know it can take place. This is not just, conjecture. It is. I know it can take place. It's a simple shift of attention. Everything looks different. The whole situation, landscape, just like that, has completely changed in terms of what you thought was there, and now you realize it's this solid block of oneness, and it's just the realization is just amazing. A simple shift of attention is all it takes. And yet we're so focused on trying to manifest what we want through our desires and the law of attraction, we don't want to stop doing that. We don't want to get our attention off the world, say, no, I'm focusing on, I need this, I want this, I desire this, I got to get this. And we're not willing to have our attention shift, this attentional shift, off of form, off of the world, off of this vast hoax that light is presenting to us. We think that'll interfere with the law of attraction, that we won't get what we want. What we really want is the vision of oneness. So what do you mean? How does it interfere? It doesn't interfere with that. It's ridiculous. You can get all the material goods and relationships in the universe and add them all up and they can't touch the vision of oneness. Okay, you can have a great relationship with everybody in the universe. You can have all the houses, the cars, the vacations, the clothing, the money, the jewelry, the whatever it is. Everything in the universe you can have, but it doesn't even touch what you experience in the vision of oneness in terms of what is it that you really want. So who cares if you're quote-unquote, you know, breaking the focus of your attraction by having your attention shift? You say, well, all that stuff won't come to me. But what will come to you is what you really want. So we got a quantity over quality issue here, don't we, in the world? We have a quantity over quality problem. We think that quantity will make up for lack of quality. It doesn't. There is one specific situation we really want. That's our attention to shift onto the vision of oneness. And once we do that, we realize instantly, ah, this is what I really want, without question. No doubt whatsoever, zero doubt. And you know the other stuff, ah, that wasn't what I really wanted. No way. So why worry about the law of attraction when you already have what you really want? And that's not a law of attraction, that's a law of shifting your attention. That's a matter of shifting your attention. The witness to all of this, to the vision of oneness, the witness, not the hero and the hero, the witness. The heroine and the hero is the one that's supposedly figuring out how to get what they want within this conflict of light. But the witness is the one that is paying attention to all this. But that's not the true witness. The true witness is beyond. It's the witness of the witness, is spirit. So there is this hurdle to get over, this hurdle to get over. And it's proving to be a very difficult hurdle, even though the shift is incredibly easy. Incredibly easy. Incredibly easy. I've been trying to get the shift to happen again. For some reason, I've not been able to quite get it to happen. But I will keep trying for sure. It's very easy. It's simply a willingness to do it. So hopefully bringing all this stuff to light just loosens up the whole thing, situation, and we just realize, okay, I just asked the Holy Spirit to keep on bringing to light what needs to be brought to light so I can get to the point where I say, okay, I will do it, that's it. That's the whole situation. Evaporate this continuity fear. Remember, this entire dream is super delusional. So don't try to fix any of it. Shift your attention to the vision of oneness. Don't say, well, what will become of me? Or the women might say, oh, you're not going to serve us, be our slaves anymore. What's going to happen to us again? It's totally delusional. That's just a play of light. There's nothing there that is us at all. That's the problem of the light. You know, not our problem. You know, it's the light saying, well, how am I going to capture your attention, keep catching your attention? You don't need to. It's like, you don't need, just like in one mirage, you see a more better mirage that reminds you of reality, and you turn your attention away from the other mirage, and the other mirage says, well, what's going to happen to me? You know, what do you mean, you're a mirage? You're not needed anymore. So, part of the shtick of the light is to say, this is all there is. This is all the light can do. You change the light. This is it. You can't go back. So the light will say, oh, you shifted to the vision of oneness. Well, what's going to happen to this play of light? You know, because that's all there is. No, it's not. That's just light responding to one silly little request that we had. Okay, so we just have to keep pushing forward here. Bringing stuff to light in a non-judgmental, non-mean-spirited way, in a humorous way. And just be aware of this stuff. You know, just be aware of what's taking place in the world and don't hate it, because again, it's a play of light we asked for. We asked for all this madness, this circus here. And just keep in mind, we can shift our attention off of this. Shift attention off of this. To the vision of oneness. Which is what we really want. Keep emphasizing that. It's got to click at some point. Okay. Very great. That's it.